You're not going to be wise unless you understand the priority of the inner life, the complexity of the inner life, the solitude of the inner life, and the healing of the inner life. A man's spirit sustains him in sickness, but a crushed spirit, who can bear? The human spirit is roughly analogous to what we would call today emotional energy, passion for life, that which propels us out into life, makes us want life, makes us want to take it on, navigate, deal with it. A crushed spirit, then, is to look out at life and to have no desire for it, have little or no joy in it, have no passion to get out there and deal with it. And of course, there's degrees of a crushed spirit. It can be anywhere from listlessness and restlessness, discouragement, to despondency, to being very, very cast down, to losing all desire to live. There is nothing more important than maintaining your inner being. When it says, a man's spirit sustains him in sickness, but a crushed spirit who can bear, here's what it's saying. A broken body can be sustained with difficulty by a strong spirit, but a crushed or broken spirit can never be sustained or carried by the strongest body of all. In other words, this proverb is getting at something that actually the whole Bible gets at. We human beings are obsessed with the idea that our happiness is determined by our external circumstances, that our happiness is completely determined by whether our body is healthy or whether our body is looks good, whether we have money, whether people are treating us right, whether things are going well out there. That's what makes us happy or that's what makes us unhappy, when the Bible actually says no. It has nothing to do with your circumstances. Happiness is determined by how you deal with your circumstances from inside, how you process, how you address, how you view them. If your life is all broken, all things are wrong, and your spirit is strong, your and powerful, you move out into the world in strength. But if everything about your life is going fine, all the circumstances are doing fine, but your spirit is crushed, you move out into the world in weakness. Or put it another way, are you far, far, far more concerned to deposit grace in your spirit than you are to deposit money in your bank account? If you're not, you're a fool. The priority of the inner life. Now, secondly, you're not wise if we don't see the priority, but secondly, you're not going to live a wise life unless you see the complexity of the inner life. So what do you do to keep your inner being from deteriorating? A spirit. What causes a crushed spirit? Why do our emotions and our feelings seem to get out of control? Why do we get so downcast sometimes? Why do we lose all passion for life? Why do we struggle so much? And you know what the biblical answer is? It's complicated. The Bible gives you the most fully nuanced, the most complex assessment of what can go wrong and lead to despondency and lead to a crushed spirit. Okay? Here's five. First of all, a crushed spirit may have a physical aspect. A tranquil life gives life to the flesh, but passion makes the bones rot. And the word passion means literally a hot feeling. That word can refer to anger or bitterness or envy or fear or something like that. But what it's giving us here is a very nuanced and sophisticated understanding of the relationship of the body to the emotions. Emotional unhealth leads to physical unhealth in all kinds of ways. Disintegration, deterioration. But what's the implication? The implication, of course, is that since the body and the emotions are united, then bodily weakness can lead to emotional unhealth. If you're weary, if you're not eating right, if you've got chemical imbalances, there's a physical aspect to your spirit, to being crushed in spirit. There can be. There often is. The crushed spirit is in your head. But the point is, if you lose all desire to even live because of something wrong with your body, you've got a crushed spirit. It doesn't matter what the cause is, and one of the causes can be the physical. Secondly, there's an emotional, relational aspect. An anxious heart weighs a man down, but a kind word cheers him up. You need an outside word of love, of kindness. You need support. Sometimes you don't need medicine. Sometimes you don't need therapy. You don't need an answer. You don't need complicated reflection. You need love sometimes. Because we have an emotional, relational nature, you just need arms around you. You need a shoulder. You need intimacy. You need support. Because we have an emotional, relational nature. Third, there's a moral aspect. The wicked man flees, though no one pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. It's a quote from Leviticus 26, where God says, if you disobey me, you will flee, though no one pursues. It's talking about conscience. It's talking about guilt. It's talking about what can go wrong inside, in your spirit, in your emotions. What can go wrong inside if you know that you're not living right, if you know you're not living up to standards, if you feel guilt, if you feel shame, if you feel like a failure in any way. But look how nuanced it is. It doesn't say you flee when someone pursues, you flee when no one pursues. Guilt just generalizes. A sense that there's something wrong with you just generalizes. So you not only feel guilty for some things you ought to feel guilty for, but you also can't help then feeling guilty for all kinds of things you shouldn't feel guilty for. So someone criticizes you and you feel assaulted, attacked, bad conscience. You make a little failure and you feel like a total failure. Bad conscience. There's a moral aspect. There's a conscience aspect. Fourthly, there's an existential aspect. Even in laughter, the heart is sad, and the end of joy is grief. This is true of everybody. Do you not realize that there's an existential angst that comes down deep from under everything? Everybody knows that all parties eventually are going to be over, that all joy really does end in grief. Everything your heart wants out of life eventually will be taken away from you. Your health will be taken away from you. If you don't die a tragic young death, eventually your health will be taken away from you. Your loved ones will be taken away from you. Everything will be taken away from you. Everything. It'll all be gone. I guess that's right. I guess that's true. But, I mean, do you have to tell me about it? Do we have to think about it? Guess what? Try not to think about it. And this is saying down deep you know about it. That there is a ground note of sadness that you cannot overcome unless you have some way of dealing philosophically with, unless you have some way of ascribing meaning to the daily things that you do, which is really pretty hard. You're going to have this ground note of sadness that underneath all your laughter, you're going to be sad because you know that all joy eventually ends in grief. Now, this is a philosophical problem, and a lot of people have it. If you're not able to overcome your fear of it, if you're not able to find some way in light of death that you can ascribe meaning to the things you're doing now, today, do you see there's a medical possibility for a crushed spirit? There's an emotional, a relational, a moral, an existential, a philosophical. And you see, by the way, doctors don't want to think about philosophy, and friends don't want to think about medicine. They just want to love you. And Christians, you know, what Christians do? Well, we turn everything into moral. We turn everything into a moral issue. We're reductionistic. And of course, the people who are into self-esteem, what do they say? Well, it's all emotional and relational. And of course, the people who think we're just a body, what do they say? It's all the physical. And that's not all. There's a physical aspect, there's an emotional aspect, there is a moral aspect, there's an existential aspect, and finally, there's a faith aspect. A happy heart makes the face cheerful, but heartache crushes the spirit. Heartache crushes the spirit. In the Bible, the heart is your core commitments, the things you most fundamentally trust, the things you most fundamentally love, the things you most fundamentally are living for, the things you most fundamentally hope in. Second proverb says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but longing fulfilled is a tree of life. And that word longing means a desire from the depths of your personality. Now, when your heart has been set on something, and it's got to be set on something, you've got to set your heart on something as your ultimate hope, your ultimate trust, the thing you're looking for to really make yourself happy, really make yourself feel significant, the thing you say, if I have that, then my life means something, then I know I'm somebody, then I know I'm all right. And you've got to put your heart on something because we are, that's the kind of beings we are. And this is telling you that if you put your heart on something in the most fundamental way and any problem happens to it, anything threatens it, in any way, it's deferred. You won't even want to live. You'll be crushed in spirits. If you really look at somebody else and say, you're my fundamental hope, you're the thing that really makes me know that I'm okay, you break up with that person, you won't even want to live. Go into Barnes & Noble, and you'll never find a book that will tell you how complicated you really are. Every book on emotional health, every book on counseling, every book is going to reduce you. It's going to simplify you. But you're not just a body. You're not just your emotions. You're not just your conscience. You're not just a will. You're not just your thinking. You are a man or a woman in the image of God. And God's image is stamped on absolutely every aspect of your being. And unless you're living with every aspect of your being before God, you are going to have despondency, you are going to have out of control emotions, you're going to have despair, you're going to have a crushed spirit that you will not be able to remedy. And you'll get the books and you'll go and listen to people who tell you the way to emotional health, and they'll always be too simple, they'll always be foolish. Now, you're not going to be wise unless you see the priority of the inner life, the complexity of the inner life. Now, thirdly, you also have to see the solitude of the inner life. Each heart knows its own bitterness, and no one can share its joy. Here's what this is saying. Your insides, the movements and motions of your heart are so complex, and they're so inward, and they're so hidden, that there's an irreducible, unavoidable solitude about human existence. Nobody will ever completely understand you. Nobody. You know what they're going to do? They're going to do the same thing to you that you're doing to them. You're going to think you understand them. You're going to put them in a category. So, oh, it's just like what happened to me, or it's just like what happened to so-and-so. No. This is saying that you are so unique and you are so hidden and you're so inward that nobody in the end, in the final analysis, will ever really understand you. You're going to have to basically go through life alone. Nobody can completely, even the people closest to you, very often just will not understand you. And you can sense that. And it's horribly disappointing, but this is saying get over that. Don't be shocked at being misunderstood. It says all a man's ways seem innocent to him, but motives are weighed by the Lord. You know what that's saying? You don't even understand yourself. You have absolutely no idea what's all down there. You have a better idea than anybody else, but nothing compared to what God can see. You are alone. There is nobody, no human being, that can walk with you everywhere you go. There is no human being that can help you interpret, really, everything you're going through. But you know what this means? If God's not a friend, if God isn't someone you know personally, if God isn't someone you have a personal relationship with, if you don't have sometimes a sense of God really with you, putting His love and His truth palpably on your heart, if you don't have an intimate personal relationship with God, you are utterly alone in the world. You are absolutely alone in the world, and human beings can't live in that kind of isolation. He's the only one that can walk with you through every dark valley. He's the only one who can understand. He's the only one. And if you don't have Him, and I don't see, it's not good enough to be good or moral or even to believe in God in some general way. If you don't have Him as a personal friend, if you don't have an intimate personal relationship, a sense of real dealing with Him, you are utterly alone. If you've got a crushed spirit, what do we do? And here's the answer. The secret is the tree of life. What do I mean by the secret being the tree of life? Through wisdom, the book of Proverbs says, you can actually get a taste of it. And what does the tree of life mean? What does it represent? It represents not just endless life, eternal life being endless. It represents fullness of life. Absolute satiation of the deepest desires. You've got creative desires to accomplish things. You've got aesthetic desires for beauty. You've got romantic and relational desires for love. You've got epistemic desires for knowledge. And the tree of life represents absolute satiation a million times over of the greatest amount you could think you could want. And that's the tree of life. But the book of Genesis also tells us that we lost it. The end of Genesis chapter 3 says, and there was a flaming sword that turns and sweeps back and forth, keeping us from the tree of life. Because when we turned to be our own masters, to be our own saviors, to be our own lords, when we decided we want to be in charge of our own lives, we lost the tree of life. Now, what does that mean? What it's really saying is our deepest longings, the things we put our hearts on to fulfill our deepest longings, will never fulfill them, because what we're really looking for in everything we do is the tree of life. In other words, when you get into your career and you get so excited about the new career, when you get a new boyfriend or girlfriend, when you get into a new relationship, when you go on a vacation, when you travel to someplace you've never been, there's always something, it promises something that it can never actually deliver. This tree of life image in the Bible is not simply referring to eternal life. In the Bible, the tree of life is an image of immortal eternal life, but also it's an image of irretrievable loss. It's an image of cosmic nostalgia, a longing for something we remember yet we've never had. What you're looking for in love is you're looking for arms that you remember but you never really had. That's what the Bible's saying. That's what the tree of life is. And unless you understand that what you're looking for and everything you're looking for is the tree of life, you're not going to be wise. You start to realize that every single thing you looked for to give you a certain satisfaction, it never really delivers. And what's the solution? Do you know that the New Testament continually says that Jesus died on a tree? Yeah, in the book of Acts, in 1 Peter 2, and Galatians 3, they hung him on a tree. He was nailed to a tree. He died on a tree. Have you ever wondered about that? Have you said, that's kind of an exaggeration? It was a cross. I mean, obviously, there was a big trunk and... But it wasn't really a tree, was it? Why do they say a tree? Oh, it's so significant, and I'll tell you what. Jesus lost his ultimate hope. He put all of his hope in his Father, and the only person in the history of the world who put his ultimate hope in his Father, the Father, and he lost the Father eternally on the cross. He was crushed in spirit. He was infinitely crushed. He went through all that agony. Why? For us, to pay the penalty. The cross was a tree of death. But because he climbed the tree of death, we have the tree of life. Now, to the degree you let that melt your heart, to the degree you see what he did for you, to the degree you rejoice in that, to the degree you orient your heart toward that and it just melts you at the thought of that love, to that degree you will experience what Tolkien calls joy beyond the walls of the world. He took the tree of death so you could have the tree of life. Use that on your emotion. Use that on your conscience. Use that on your existential angst. Put your hope in him. Take hold of the gospel. Work it into one another's lives, not just into your own life. And you will know power in your inmost being.